That brings us to our plant of the month, and we'll just ask people to stop using the annotate. Our plant of the month this month, thinking about April, and of course this feature we started this year with our plant of the month, in that we're looking at plants that do more by feeding birds and feeding pollinators. We're focusing on plants that can be grown across North Carolina and that are commercially available, but maybe not at every garden center or big box store you walk into. So it may take a little bit more looking for maybe nurseries that specialize in perennials or native plants to find some of these. But they are plants that deserve to be better known. And so this month with April, we see the return of the hummingbirds to North Carolina. I've already seen several. And so we want to feature a plant that is great for hummingbirds. But first, I also wanted to mention that you can review all of the plants of the month and weeds of the month on our archive. So you'll see the link is down here. And that will take you to some online slides, which you can flip through and see the slides from past plants of the month. So if you remember, we had some really cool plants of the month back in February, but you can't quite remember what it is, this will take you there and let you look at all of them. We'll build it out throughout the year. And again, I'll be posting these links in the chat box soon, as well as sending them in the follow-up email. Okay, so if you were really quick, you probably already saw that our plant of the month this month is cross vine, Bignonia capreolata. This is a climbing vine, of course, that's native to the east and central United States. It has a really wide range, and it is found throughout North Carolina, but not in the mountains, especially not at higher elevations. It is hardy from zone 6 to zone 9, so it's very heat tolerant. But in colder climates, sometimes you'll see it listed to 5B, but it can actually freeze back to the ground. In some of those colder climates, it'll come back from the roots. But it does bloom on old growth, so if it does freeze back in a year and has to grow back from the roots, you won't have any blooms that year. Naturally, you'll find it usually in low wooded areas along stream banks, and often it scrambles high up into the trees searching for sunlight. So usually what you see are the flowers laying on the ground when you're walking along the stream bank or in the woods. You'll see these flowers laying over the ground and say, well, where is that coming from? And then look up and you'll find it up in the trees. It is semi-evergreen, so in milder areas and further south, it will stay pretty much solid evergreen. But here, I know in the Piedmont, it loses a lot of its leaves. It keeps a few leaves for the winter. In the garden, it is pretty tolerant of soil type. It can be moist soil, well-drained soil. It's drought tolerant. And it even tolerates flooding, as you would imagine, being from those stream banks. And I would recommend growing it in full sun. It will tolerate shade, but the more shade it's in, the more it's going to look for light. So that means it's just going to grow taller and taller till it reaches the top of whatever's shading it. So if you keep it in sun, it tends to stay a little more compact. It is currently blooming April and May. The wild form, as we saw in the previous picture, is red on the outside with the yellow blush on the petals that open up. You can imagine that hummingbirds love these tubular flowers. They're really attracted to flowers in shades of red, purple, and violet. So this is quite an attractive plant to them. Bees also love it. You can see in the picture there's a little tiny sweat bee inside. This plant is in my yard, and at the same time there were also some giant bumblebees going in and out. And then there were some carpenter bees, which I watched, and they would just go up to the top of the tube and poke a hole in it and access the nectar that way. So they were making a shortcut. So lots of bees will visit it. The hummingbirds will visit it. In the wild, it is pretty variable. Even though the typical form is that red and yellow, you will find naturally just fairly solid red forms or more soft yellow forms. And a lot of gardeners have noticed those and selected different varieties. So this is one of those variants, natural variants, called Tangerine Beauty, that was selected by the J.C. Rawson Arboretum, which I really like this variety because of these very nice, bright apricot-colored blossoms. And it can just be totally covered, the whole vine. It does climb by tendrils, these kind of little clinging tendrils. So it can grow on brick, as you see. It can grow naturally. It grows up trees. So it's really, it likes to have those little cracks and crevices, like you think of tree bark that it can kind of stick into. We have some planted on snags, so on dead trees, just let them kind of cover the dead tree or a tall post, and it looks really nice that way. On brick over a long time with those little clinging tendrils, you can imagine it might could cause some issues with the mortar. So I would be careful where you do plant it. Certainly give it somewhere it has lots and lots of space. And one thing that you, when you do see it, you notice it has these kind of unique leaves. It has opposite leaves, and there's usually two leaves or four leaves at each node, two sets of two. So it kind of, it gives it, it almost looks like it's whirled, you know, whirled and against the brick wall there. So that is a ID feature in the wild when it's not in bloom, is this is a fairly unique leaf arrangement with those opposite leaves where they're born in pairs at each node. And as I mentioned, it's a pretty vigorous vine. It is definitely not something to put on your mailbox unless you never want to see your mailbox again. It needs a pretty decent sized structure. And this is from a few years ago at the J.C. Ralston Arboretum. I'm not sure, I don't think it's still there. I think when they redid the Laugh House, I don't know that they replanted the Bignonia. But they had a cultivar named Jekyll, which is quite similar to the Tangerine Beauty. And it was a beautiful vine covering much of that Laugh House. So you can see it is just one vine and it's spreading out. And as you see, totally covered in flowers. So it does need a pretty decent size and sturdy structure, but it will definitely repay your efforts with a beautiful flower show every year in the spring. All right, so that brings us to our weed of the month. Unless we had any questions, and I was trying to look really quick in the chat, I don't see anything from our plant of the month, Bignonia. So our weed of the month, I want to thank Mike Munster for suggesting this one. So does anybody recognize it? You can put in the chat if you have a guess for what our weed of the month this month is. It's a very common weed that you have probably encountered. Probably wish you didn't encounter it. Have any brave people want to hazard a guess? This is it, the seedling stage. We've got a guess of pokeweed. Got a guess of poison ivy. Yep, poison ivy. Yep, we got it. Oh, we got smilax, I guess. So hopefully some people will recognize it or my tip of not encountering it, but this is a very, very young poison ivy seedling. These are the cotyledons or the seed leaves, and you can see many plants in dicots. So they have two cotyledons, so they have this really generic shape, first leaf, the seed leaf, and then the true leaves come out. And that's when you can tell more about what it is, but this still looks a little, you can't, it's not obvious this is poison ivy because that, see the little tiny leaflets have not yet expanded near the base, you've just got one leaflet showing. So poison ivy is greening back up and the seeds are sprouting. And it is something definitely to be on the lookout. And this you might recognize more. This is just some poison ivy that has mature, a big mature plant of poison ivy that has leafed out. Lots of those new tender leaves. So you can see those three leaflets. Of course, poison ivy is a native deciduous vine. And it is common in those similar areas to the crossvine, those low wooded areas, the shaded landscapes, anywhere it's moist, you'll run into it, moist and shady are its favorite habitats. It is fairly easily recognized by the compound leaves, which are trifoliate. So they have three leaflets wherever the leaves attach. The leaves are alternate on the stem. And the old saying about leaflets three, let it be. So that will give you a clue about whether it's poison ivy. It can sometimes be confused with Virginia creeper, which is similar looking, but it has five leaflets. And Virginia creeper is not actually closely related to poison ivy at all. So quite a different vine, but just happens to have a similar leaf structure. So three leaves for poison ivy, five leaflets for Virginia creeper. And it can be pretty variable, so don't concentrate too much on the edge of the leaf. You can see here it's got a really smooth edge, but it can also be toothed or lobed. But think about those three leaflets. Think about a vine, alternate leaves on the stem. And the part of poison ivy that we don't want to encounter is a toxic oil called urushiol, which I hope I'm pronouncing correctly, and that's what causes a skin irritation. And so I see we've got some questions about whether the seedling leaves are cause that same amount of reaction. And I spent some time yesterday trying to find that, and I did not find exactly whether the seedling leaves were caused as much reaction as, say, other parts of the plant. But I did find this really interesting study I wanted to share way back from 1977 of what parts of the plant are most likely to cause a reaction. So this looked at different parts of the poison ivy plant and what the urushiol content was. And you can see they are listed here from most to least. And you can see the bark is number one, which it is true if you burn poison ivy, it can become, that urushiol can become airborne. If you're sensitive to it and inhale that smoke, you can really be in serious trouble with having that reaction in your lung tissue and your throat. So you have to be very careful to always, if you're burning wood, to see if there is poison ivy present. But here, for this time of year, this is extremely relevant. It is the fresh young stems and the fresh young leaves which have the highest amount of this urushiol after the bark. So it is this real glossy new growth that comes out. Sometimes it has this reddish tint, as you can see here, which is going to cause the most severe reaction. So if you can just imagine, if you're out there mowing and you hit some of this and it splatters, or you're weed trimming, this is really going to cause a reaction if you're sensitive to poison ivy, as many of us are. So even later in the year, after the plants have grown, there's always typically new growth, you know, at the tip. So you always have to be careful of this, but in the spring is when it's going to be really, really important to look out for this, because it's pretty much all going to be new growth. I thought it was very interesting that if you look at the older leaves, the large leaves, once they reach full size and mature, the urushiol content goes much, much lower. I'm personally not going to test this out. I'm going to believe their study. But I thought that was a pretty huge difference between the new leaves, the fresh tender new leaves, and the older leaves, and how much the content and the potential to cause a reaction. And many of you have probably heard some of the more recent studies that have been looking at how poison ivy and other plants react to climate change and increase in carbon dioxide levels in the atmosphere, which cause plants to grow. Plants grow with carbon dioxide. So with poison ivy, not only are the leaves becoming larger, but they're also becoming more toxic. With this urushiol, there's actually a couple of different forms in the plant, and some are more irritant, more irritable than others, like for a reaction. And so higher COT levels are increasing the more potent forms of urushiol. So if you think, gosh, I seem to have a much worse reaction to poison ivy than I used to, there could be a very good reason for that. We're seeing the plants actually become more toxic and more likely to cause those reactions. So I noticed in the chat the comment about getting poison ivy from the roots as well, and that urushiol is found in all parts of the plant. So that particular study, they didn't look at the roots, but it is also in the roots. So you have to be careful with all parts of the plant. And I see that it's doing very well in Chris's yard this year. And I would definitely assume that the seedling leaves also have the urushiol and be very mindful of them. So how about managing it? It's a pretty tough weed, like many of our woody weeds, tough to manage, tough to truly get rid of. And so with many of our woody weeds, like some of the privet and even oak trees can be weeds if they're growing where you don't want them. I this year have black walnuts coming up everywhere. Apparently the squirrels were really busy last year. So it's really important if you can get them in the seedling stage and pull them up then, you know, you've saved yourself a whole world of effort later on. So watch out for the seedling stage. And of course with poison ivy, you'll definitely want to wear, not like me here, bare fingers, you'll want to wear waterproof gloves, neoprene gloves, gloves that are recommended, you know, to protect your hands against any chemicals. If you're going to be pulling up any of these type of seedlings, and then of course, wash your hands with lots of warm soapy water afterwards, or anywhere that you've been, any part of your body that may have been in contact with poison ivy. So, so hand weeding when they're small is a wonderful way to control most of our woody weeds if you can catch them at that stage. Poison ivy itself does not tolerate trimming or mowing, but it's really dangerous to trim or mow poison ivy because, as you can imagine, you hit it with a mower, weed trimmer, and it just splatters everywhere, and you're getting that tender new growth. So if you are going to be trimming poison ivy, I would recommend using hand tools so you can do it in a much more controlled way. This would just be if you have a couple of vines, and then, you know, wearing gloves and other PPE to make sure you're not getting exposed to those oils. And then so we come to herbicides, which once you have a larger established plant, this is probably what you're going to have to turn to really get rid of poison ivy or most of our woody weeds once they're well established. And so, you know, glyphosate, which is the active ingredient in many of our non-selective herbicides, such as Roundup, it is pretty effective if it's sprayed on the foliage, and actually studies have shown that it's most effective when it's sprayed in summer, when poison ivy is in the flowering stage. So if you notice the blooms on it in midsummer, that's going to be the most effective time to spray it with something like glyphosate. Also, triclopyr, which is sold as a brush killer type herbicide, will kill and help manage a lot of woody weeds. It is also non-selective, so you have to be very careful with both of these, how you apply it, that you don't get it on other plants that you want. So just be really careful in where you're applying it. And a little bit more directed way of applying the products is to, and this works for most woody plants as well, is to do a direct treatment or a cut stem treatment. So say you have a poison ivy vine growing up a tree. If you can cut it near ground level, cut it near the base, and then as soon as you cut it, paint that fresh cut with the concentrated herbicide, so pretty much straight out of the bottle. And depending on the age of the plant and health of it, that might control it completely. If not, if it starts to sprout back, and it can take a couple of months to sprout back, then when it sprouts back up, you can spray the foliage then with the diluted herbicide, and that will usually knock it out. So that's going to definitely, you'll use a lot less herbicide and have a lot more directed treatment that way. The University of Georgia Extension has a great fact sheet on controlling poison ivy where you can read more about those methods. Okay, so just checking the chat to see if we've got anything coming in. So there's a special soap that you can get from pharmacies if you're especially susceptible. Jean mentions a couple of products, herbicide products, Zanfil, Technu. Is that the, Jean, is that the soap or is that a herbicide? And then Heather, it's the soap. So the soap is called Zanfil or Technu. Then Heather has a really good tip, very, very important tip about don't forget to clean your tools after cutting poison ivy. That's absolutely true. Anything that comes in contact can spread it. So if your dog goes running through a bunch of poison ivy, you know, and then you pet your dog, you can get it that way. Yes, clean your shoes. So anything that may have come in contact, you will want to clean and try to wash off those oils with warm soapy water. Yes, and Diane mentions jewelweed, which is another native. It's actually an annual. It's a type of impatient that often grows naturally in the same habitats of poison ivy. Is a natural anecdote, and you'll see a lot of recommendations for crushing up the leaves and rubbing it on, or crushing up the leaves in water and making ice cubes and let it sit on the poison ivy. All right, so lots of great advice here for for managing the reaction you might get. And then, of course, when the plants are in your landscape, you'll usually want to get rid of them, especially if it's someone you might come in contact with them. But I do want to say poison ivy is not all bad. It is an extremely valuable plant for wildlife. It has these white berries that ripen in late summer and fall and persist through the winter and are an extremely important food source for overwintering birds. And I saw several studies. I saw the numbers 50, 55, and 60. So I went with the middle one. So at least 55 species of birds eat these fruits. So when it's in the woods and when it's in a natural area, just let it do its thing. It does serve a greater purpose. And it also has beautiful fall color. So we can admire it from afar. And with that, I'm going to turn it over to Matt and Mike to tell us about the great pictures they got in and share with us what kind of pests and plant diseases are happening across North Carolina.
Thanks, Charlotte. Okay, I'm going to start. Okay, where is that? I'm going to start sharing our presentation. Yes, so today we're going to talk about taking some photos. We did this several years ago, about 7 years ago, and we're going to, because we're closed right now for most physical samples, we would like to take this opportunity to let people know some of the techniques and tips on how to take good photos for diagnosis. And of course, many of you sent in photos for us to look at. So I'm going to go through this section fairly quickly so we can get to all those photos that everybody sent in. Now, we didn't include everybody's. We weren't able to include everybody's, but we include as many as possible. And we're basically going to just discuss what we see in those photos. Please remember, again, to mute your mics, stop your videos, and not annotate the screens. And we'll get started. Okay, so today we're going to talk about camera types, lighting, focus, magnification, the types of photos to include, some specifics on what to photograph for insects and what to photograph for diseases. Okay, so there are various types of cameras you can use to take digital photos nowadays. SLRs, which are these big bulky ones that you can change the lenses on, fairly expensive, but take really good images depending on what your settings are and lighting. Point and shoots are the typical cameras that are not a phone camera, but are not also an SLR. They are typically compact, one lens attached to it, it's not removable. They sometimes have macro settings for taking close-ups, but you have to find that, and I'll show you that in a few minutes. And then phones, which most people have digital, you know, cell phones that have even smartphones, many people have these days that have really good cameras. And actually the lines between these cameras are blurring now as far as image quality, because the good smartphones can take very good quality images right inside. So I just want to do a very quick poll to see what you all use to take your photos. If I can find the polls, let's see. Oops, that's not what I wanted to do. Maybe Charlotte or somebody wants to start that poll. My toolbar is not coming up apparently. Oh, here we go. All right, I got this. All right, so let me know what you what you usually take your photos with, and we'll do about 30 seconds. I'm not sure what that something else would be, maybe Polaroids. I don't think anybody's using much film, but.
Maybe oil or watercolor?
Yeah, that's what I was thinking. People are drawing them by hand. Okay. So I'm going to end that poll so we can get through this. All right. Looks like most people are using their phones, and that's great. Hopefully your phones have good quality cameras. I encourage you to have a phone that takes really good quality photos if you're doing a lot of diagnostics or looking around at things, because just a base photo isn't always the best to help. You have to have some some good lenses and quality. Okay, so lighting and exposure. So daylight looks more natural, but it actually, even though it's full light, it often results in a slower shutter speed, which results in fuzzy photos when the object, the insect, is moving or your hands are moving. Flash can help, and many of the phones have a little built-in flash, so you can turn the flash on. That'll make the picture snap quicker, and it causes less blurriness. Diffuse light is good to reduce the shine and things like that. And if your photo is too dark, you can bring the sample inside and use a light source to illuminate it. So a desk lamp, something else. Now, as far as focus and clarity, so lenses have really only a certain focal distance. So you can't get so close to something or else it starts to get blurry because it's not actually focusing on the sensor. And every camera and lens is a little bit different. You can sometimes select a macro function. They often use this little flower image or an icon to show the macro setting on cameras. The longer the shutter is open, the more vibrations and movements you're going to capture. So being as still as possible while taking the image will help reduce that amount of blur. And so be patient with these cameras. Take several photos. Try to hold as still as possible. If you need to brace onto something, that's great. But basically, try and get the clearest, crispest photos possible. Now, sometimes your camera fights with you where it focuses. We see a lot of photos where the subject in the foreground is out of focus and it somehow focuses on something in the background. It doesn't usually seem to be what people intend to get focused. So a couple things, you can hold your hand or a piece of paper or something right behind the object and make the camera focus closer, then take your photo. Again, always being aware what's in focus in your photos. And on phones, of course, you can, smartphones especially, you can tap the object on the screen to focus on that point, and that'll help you out. And I'm sure most of you know how to do this, but if you don't, again, what's on the screen, just tap. And you'll see. Okay, as far as magnification, some insects and critters are too small to be photographed with typical lenses, so even phone lenses, you're not going to get a good, crisp, clear photo. So for camera phones and even point and shoots, you can actually hold a magnifying glass in front of the lens to increase magnification to a point. All right, I see some annotations coming up. Please don't do any annotations right now, thanks. Also, you can buy aftermarket or third-party clip-on or snap-on lenses for phones, which will increase the magnification. Okay, and then very important for our magnification, it's always good to include a common size reference, either a ruler, a coin, a pencil, something near the specimen so that we know how big this thing is. If you can include it, it's always good in the description when you send it to include the size of it. So let us know how big it is because the pictures can be misleading. Also, magnified photos should still be clear and in focus. Our rule of thumb is get as close as you can while it's still in focus. Once you go beyond that point of focus, it doesn't matter how big it is in the image. If it's starting to get blurry, we can't see the details. And also the size of the images that your camera takes are gonna be helpful because we can zoom in a lot more with larger photos than smaller photos. So if it's a very small photo on your screen, we're not gonna be able to zoom in with those details. So here's an example. So this is an old phone of mine where I held the magnifying glass in front and you can see with the same distance of focus, we got a larger image on the right with the magnifying glass in front. Okay, so quickly for insects, what parts to take photos of? So in general, various shots of the whole insect, especially the top and underside are good to have and maybe enough for ID. Make sure the background is not too busy also. You don't want the insect to be inadvertently camouflaged in the image on the background. So for beetles, clear shots of the feet, and I do realize that I'm showing you very crisp, clear photos that I took, and so these aren't going to be typical cell phone photos, but just illustrating what parts of the body to take photos of. So for beetles, the feet, which are called tarsi, and the antennae, you can see these two beetles have very different antennal shapes and structure. So those can be useful for ID. In flies, the wing venation, so how these wing veins are patterned, will help. Also the head and thorax and the cilia on them, and also the antennae are really important. For wasps and ants, the antennae, the face, side and top of the thorax, and the wings can be very important. For ants especially, the antennae, a number of segments and how it's clubbed, and also the way the abdomen attaches to the thorax are very important to distinguish different groups of ants. Butterflies and moths are pretty straightforward. Taking a picture of their wings and their natural posture and the patterns are gonna be good. So make sure the pattern comes out in the photos. That's probably the best advice. For spiders, the eyes, the body from above, so just the general shape, but especially the eyes, because the eye pattern for spiders is very important sometimes for ID. Spinnerets, how they spin the silk, and also the web if it's present. And larvae, you want to do a close-up of the head and appendages and the types of appendages. For instance, I want to know what whether it has true thoracic legs, these jointed legs, if it has any pro legs, these fleshy legs on the abdomen. Some have no legs. Also, here's a good size reference and making sure a lot of the details of the head and the tail, the end of the larva are very important. Also, the situation can help. So is it in wood? Is it in soil? Is it on a leaf? Things like that. Okay, final words on the insects in photography. So patience will pay off. Take multiple photos within reason from different angles to maximize the chance of ID. You don't have to send us all those photos, but it'll allow you to then pick the ones that are the best and crispest to show us. If the insect seems flighty, try to catch it and refrigerate it if you want to let it go, or freeze it to kill it and then photograph. You can also throw those on a white piece of paper with some nice light, making sure that the light isn't too intense to blow out the photo. But basically that makes it easier for you to take the photos of them. You can also bring the piece of plant material in with the insects and put it on a white piece of paper with a desk lamp over it to take the photos to get more lighting. But also note that some insects cannot be identified, especially the species, using photos and will need to be sent in. Generally, the larger, showier insects are conspicuous and thus more likely to be recognizable. And so I'll actually show you some of these examples when we get into people's photos. Okay, now I'm going to hand control over to Mike. Let's see if I can.
Hey, Matt, there was a question in the chat about that first insect you showed that was on a green leaf, about what it was.
The one that was on when I was getting the insect, specific about insects?
Yeah, it was on a green leaf. There were two shots of it from different angles.
Oh, let's see, real quick. Let's see. This one?
No.
Yeah.
No?
It's a true fruit. What's that?
I think the question came up with it was the wax scale on the focusing slide, that one.
Okay. This one?
Yes, it's a wax scale.
Mm-hmm. I had the wrong one.
Okay. Sorry, I was not looking at the chat. Let's see. All right, let me give Mike some control. All right, Mike, it's waiting for you. And
all right, let's see what happens here. Good morning again, everyone. Hope this finds you well. And as far as the disease side, it's a little bit more difficult than it is for the critter side. So very often, we're not going to be able to give you a diagnosis based just on the image sample, which is unfortunate in these times when we are not at this time in the clinic accepting physical samples from landscapes, be it commercial or homeowner landscapes. There are some diseases though that we can identify readily from photographs. So this would have been a scene that you might have seen about 2 months ago, a month and a half ago, with the tilia of cedar quince rust on the eastern red cedar. Or what we'll be seeing toward the end of May, beginning of June, when we see what's probably that quince rust, again, the one of the gymnosporangium rusts anyway, forming its isia on the fruits and stems of a lot of our calorie pears around town. So some of those, of course, we can tell you what they are, others we can't. But in order to give us the best possible pictures, whether it be image only or as complements, as supplements to the physical samples, in which case we like them because they can tell us things about the setting and the distribution, the severity that we can't get from the physical specimen, and to show parts that are too large to submit. And even as a first round where we'll often say, based on the pictures, this or that plant would be good to sample, etc. So some tips though on how to get the best out of your samples, or excuse me, your pictures that you're taking for disease diagnosis. One of them is to work from different distances and angles. And this was a great example a while back now, it's been quite a few years, this arborvitae from a church landscape that had browning out on part of it. And in another photograph that they submitted, there was a view that included not only the tree there, but part of the lawn. And the question here, I mean, this isn't that church setting, because it was brickwork there, but where you could see, in this case, you can see what portion of the tree is affected. You can see that there's a little bit of damage to the lawn there too. And in the case that I was starting to talk about, the issue was whether or not some chemical that had been sprayed to clean the brickwork might have been responsible for the damage. And the damage to the lawn was sort of circumstantial evidence that that may have been the case. But you can see how much more information we have based on the second photograph than just having the first one. Here's another example. This was a Atlantic white cedar from a plantation down east somewhere, where we not only see the setting, but we, in this particular case, had the fungus caught red-handed. It's our only mushroom-forming fungus. It's a plant pathogen in our area, which is armillaria. So this tree had armillaria root rot. And there's almost nothing I can think of more frustrating than to be looking at a photograph of a tree and trying to scroll down to see the base of the trunk, right where it goes into the ground, and not being able to get there because the photograph is cut off. All right. That I seem to have lost control of the slide advancing. Try this button here. Okay. Another tip is to always include photographs of both the upper and lower surface of the leaves, both for diseases and for abiotic problems. That can be a really helpful clue. And if you do have the ability to take extreme close-ups, and I don't know, Charlotte, do you want to say anything about the pictures that you took here?
Sure. So this was from my zucchini leaf in Chatham County. We have recently been purchasing, excuse me, some little USB pluggable microscopes. Pluggable is the brand name. It is, you connect it to your computer through the USB. And I actually figured out after taking this picture, it was on fairly low resolution, that I could increase the resolution a lot. So most of our county centers should either have one of those right now or should be getting it in. And it's really simple to use. It's great for doing close-ups. And you can change the resolution of the image. So make sure you've got it on that highest setting. We've got several that are still being mailed out. So when they get into more of the centers, we'll meet with agents and just walk through some of the basics of using them, and so folks can get the most out of them.
Right. And now I'm not picking on Charlotte, and we're certainly not picking on any of our Master Gardener volunteers who sent in the photos, but we will be critiquing some of these. And in this case, the critique is that, well, two. One is that such a close photograph without the context of what the whole leaf looks like and the whole plant looks like really is, we're not able to do much with. The other is, this would have benefited from the top and bottom view of the leaf. I don't know that, that second one was the bottom, because what we would be looking for here would be any kind of fungal sporulation on that spot. To me, that doesn't necessarily look like a disease spot, but I really can't tell from the photograph alone. Here's another example. I'm sorry, go ahead.
Yeah, I was gonna say, Mike, it has disappeared. So my zucchini plants have outgrown that. So it must have been just a temporary something.
Good, very good. I'm glad your zucchini will live to feed the squash vine borers later in the season. Hopefully you get something before they do as well. This is an example of a photograph that does show the underside, the symptom on the top, the stippling, and then the underside that Charlotte sent, which you can, even I can identify the spider mites there, which would have been probably the cause of the stippling on this Lanisera. For lawns, it's particularly important to get that view looking out across the turf. These are both centipede lawns here on the left. What you're seeing is green areas of weeds because the turf has gone dormant. So these are areas that would have died earlier, and then the weeds came in to fill the holes. Our turf specialist says this was probably a case of large patch that caused this. And then on the right would be a typical fairy ring type symptom. So looking out across the turf. Now there is use done as well of having pictures of specifically any kind of spot on the leaf or the stolons, but don't leave out that general view across the lawn. In fact, there's an interesting one here. In this particular sample, it came in quite a few years ago now. There was no disease activity, and somehow there's certain organisms that may not necessarily show up in the photographs that are taken, but if they do, they give a clue as to what may have been the real problem here. Now, Matt mentioned taking a number of pictures within reason, and there is kind of a law of diminishing returns where one picture is infinitely better than none, and then several is quite a bit better than one, but you get to the point where any additional photograph doesn't really add much to the story. Sometimes it does, so this is not a blanket condemnation of the people who send in a lot of photographs, but in general, if you're sending 3, 5, 6 pictures, that's usually good enough, especially if you try and do the different angles and different distances to help us get a feel for the situation in the landscape. Obviously, if multiple plants are being affected, you need to include photos of more than one, then that rule would be relaxed. Another tip, and Matt talked about lighting. Well, my tip about lighting is use your body or your big wide brim hat that you're wearing to keep the sun off you to also shed some shade on the specimen, because direct sun can cause a lot of contrast between the lighted areas and the shaded portions of the plant in question, whereas you can kind of tone down some of those contrast differences by using your body or your hat to let the focus, the area in focus be shaded. And you can see that this powdery mildew here is popping out a lot more clearly on the right. And you also see some kind of stippling and mottling that you might not have seen in the photograph on the left. And this is another example here. Don't forget to show the base of the plant. This was a gardenia that we had in our yard, and it is no longer there. The situation was that there was cold injury, and you know that because of that bark splitting down at the very base of the main stem. Turned out that it had other problems too, and when I dug it up, I confirmed what I really already knew, which is that it had quite a bit of root knot nematode on it. And here's an example that Dan in Lauderdale sent in a while back now, it's just showing the importance of pulling that mulch away. So you can see here, can I annotate from your, yes I can. If you see here from this photograph that there's a large girdling root around the base of that stem. So that may be actually the primary cause of the issue here. If you have the possibility of scraping away the bark, splitting open a branch that you've cut, then that can also give us some good clues as to whether you've got blue stain or maybe some necrosis in the cambium or decay into the wood as well. And in some cases, such as this branch here, where it looked like you had a big ugly canker, but cutting into the bark showed that in fact there was healthy wood under that, just a physical wound that had started to heal over. Let me do one thing here. And finally, if your photograph is not contemporary with your request for information or diagnosis, make sure and let us know that you took it last year or in the spring or 50 years ago or whenever it happened to be, and where it was if it was not at your location. If we see something that doesn't seem to fit with the geographic area where your picture seems to be coming from, this especially happens with some of the things that come in through the Ask the Expert, where we don't really know what geographic area they're from. And that's really helpful to us to be able to know what kind of things to expect, both in terms of pests and diseases. And non-pest arthropods, excuse me, Matt. And now for your submissions, let's see, we've got, wow, we've only got a little over half an hour here. So Matt, if you want to take back your control of the...
I've got control now. Okay, sorry if I'm not looking at chat right this second. We're gonna try and go through these since we don't have a lot of time. If there's any major questions, maybe I'll look at them and answer them at the end. But one other thing is that, again, we will be critiquing these photos a little bit. Please don't take that personally. We also know that everybody has different abilities of their camera and physical abilities, things like that. So these are just, we're just giving you tips and recommendations for how to not have to go back and take multiple photos or go back and forth with us. It's best to get the best photos you can from the get-go. And so to begin, this photo, this landed on my daughter's leg, and we're gonna quote people's what they sent us. For the longer ones, I guess we probably won't read the whole thing. But anyway, this is a very large beetle, is actually one of our more distinct beetles around. This is called the eyed click beetle, Alaus oculatus. Larvae live under the bark of decaying wood and logs where they are predators. Now note that we not only have the eyed click beetle, we also have the lesser-eyed click beetle, Myops is the species name. You notice that the spots are a little bit smaller, it's a little bit more gray. But anyway, these are the one of the largest, probably the largest genus, largest species of click beetles around here in North Carolina, get about 2 inches long. Very large beetles.
Let me just chime in there. A good thing about the submitter there was that they indicated the width of those deck boards. They didn't have a ruler or anything, but they knew to specify a reference in the size of those boards.
Definitely, and that's really good to do no matter what. In this case, of course, the insect is so distinct, there's just nothing else that looks like it and I would have been able to tell them what size it was anyway. But yeah, it's really good to include the size reference. Here's another. These flies right now are really out and about. I saw a lot of them in my lights recently. This one came into this person's house. They are sometimes called by people mosquito hawks, but they don't actually eat mosquitoes, nor are they mosquitoes. They are crane flies. There are lots of different species of crane flies around. These large ones are in the genus Tipula, typically, and their larvae live on decaying matter and plant roots and things like that in yards and in leaf litter, in streams. And different times of year, different species will come out and swarm. They are attracted to lights and they are completely harmless. So just leave them alone. You can even catch them by hand. They cannot bite or do anything like that. They're fairly fragile, but very common. Okay, Gina Myers sent this. This is Canna, and she was suspecting that this might be the greater Canna leaf roller, which makes holes in Canna leaves when they're rolled up. It's a very large caterpillar. But in this case, I don't suspect that's what this is. There are a lot of issues that happen to leaves that are rolled and then expand that can mimic that, because what happens is something gets into the leaf, it can affect the leaf tissue, and it affects multiple layers. And when it unfolds, you see this symmetrical pattern. And in this case, it's not eaten through. There's this very diffuse stippling and this very diffuse white line between there. Although I can't be certain, I suspect that something fell in there and caused either physical or chemical damage to the tip of the leaf while it was still rolled up. And then when it started to expand, you see this strange symmetrical pattern. Okay, now another pattern. This is on the branches of viburnum. These little squares, the cutouts of bark, are actually from sapsucker woodpeckers. Now, sapsucker woodpeckers will attack various types of plants, trees and woody shrubs especially. In some cases, many cases, especially hickories, some of the cedars and some conifers, they'll create holes, a row of holes along the horizontally along the trunks. They look like somebody drilled at very regular intervals. What they do is they feed on the sap, and then they also may come and eat the insects that are attracted to the sap. In many hosts, though, they actually chisel out these square holes. And if it isn't too damaging, the plant will grow out of it, it'll heal. But if it girdles the plant, it can actually cause death above that area. So if you ever see a tree that is half dead, or a few limbs are completely dead, check for physical injury, especially from sapsuckers. And in fact, Charlotte forwarded this one to me. So on the left, we can see, again, similar kinds of chiseling. But on the right, Charlotte and other people have suspected sometimes wasps of doing this. Another suspicion could be squirrels, which will also chew on bark. But as far as I know, and what I think is, this is just a different type of pattern for sapsucker damage. You can see it's very deep and across the grain. Wasps typically will chew along the grain and very shallowly because they're collecting pulp to make their paper nests. In this case, you can see how far down that was chiseled, and really wasps could not chew that, and you'd basically be seeing lots and lots of wasps on the trees. I've seen this on numerous times where the birds, as again, what I assume are the birds, chiseling across the grain, and it really just depends. You can actually see on this left photo, the same tree that's been attacked in this manner has been attacked in the linear manner over here. So it depends on the species of tree and maybe the bird's preference, but they have different ways to attack different types of trees. Typically, you see the square holes and these lines on thinner barked trees like hollies, camellias, things like that. Whereas the thicker barked ones, they often drill the holes like hickories and cedars and whatnot. And there is really no good control for sapsuckers. It's illegal to kill woodpeckers. There's really no deterrence. You just have to hope for the best and hope that your plants make it through it and aren't damaged completely.
And if I can just chime in there, yeah, some plants will tolerate quite a bit of damage like this, but we have seen, and it's interesting that this is a Nellie R. Stevens holly, we have seen several cases of hollies where the upper portion of the crown is starting to go yellow, and you look closely at where the transition is and you'll see this kind of damage on the trunk. So mm-hmm. It can cause issues.
Yep. Okay, this bug was on my deck in Asheville last summer, which I would have questioned if you took a photo right now of this bug, and I'll tell you why in a second. Pretty cool looking, like a dinosaur. I do think these look a lot like dinosaurs. Now these photos, luckily the insect is very distinct. But the photos are a little out of focus. You can see that much of the details are out of focus. Again, it's large and showy, so it's much easier to identify, but if it was a less distinct insect, it would be better to have it more in focus. But this is a wheel bug. Wheel bugs are very common in North Carolina. No other assassin bug gets as big or has this cog on the back, this buzzsaw almost, but they mentioned it was last summer. That's important because you won't see any of them like this right now at this time of year. All the ones at this time of year are going to be middle-aged nymphs. They're not newly born, newly hatched, but they're also not about to molt. But in a month or so, you're going to start seeing the adults. And that's because they overwinter as eggs. They'll hatch in the spring. You won't really see the adults until the whole generation has grown up and to become adults. It depends nowadays, but usually early to midsummer. Okay, here's another thing. This is a very distinct caterpillar. This is on hazelnut, which may be fed on by this caterpillar, but this caterpillar typically likes cherries and apple, cherry, and rosaceous hosts. This is the eastern tent caterpillar. Very large and fuzzy, bluish orange with a long white stripe down its back. These are the ones that create tents or the silken nests in the crotches of trees in the spring. They came out a little bit early this year. I also, on Twitter, identified what looks like a cocoon. They'll basically, after they're done feeding, they're very large and done feeding, they'll go pupate, create a cocoon, emerge soon as adults, mate, and then they live the rest of their life this year as eggs, typically on cherry trees. And the egg masses are very distinct. I've talked about them before. But anyway, that's what this is, an eastern tent caterpillar. Okay, there's been a lot of these lately. We're going to see some more later, and I have a lot in my house. But these are cottony scales. They're not cottony cushion scales, but most likely they're cottony camellia scale on holly. And you can see these are younger ones. They're still just brownish and shiny, but as they get bigger, they're orangish and they create this long waxy tube. And this wax tube is where their eggs are laid. You can see this all over the euonymus. Euonymus gets other types of scales, but in this case, you could tell these very large, long white tubes with the orange scale is cottony scale, and they're in the genus Pulvinaria or closely related genera. Now, one thing to note, the second pick is the black city mold that came off onto the house. So that's not entirely true. These are good photos, but what happens is it's not that the city mold goes off onto the house. What happens is the bush above the house will have scales that produce honeydew that falls onto the house, and then the city molds don't care what type of surface, they're just feeding on the sugary excretions, the honeydew. And so if the honeydew falls on cars or the house or other objects below it, that'll create the sooty mold issue. All right, well, I'm gonna give Mike control again.
All right, thank you, Matt.
Well, Mike, I'm going to take control 1 second just to mute myself.
Okay. I would have welcomed your interjections, but we'll figure out if you want to, then I guess the chat box.
Well, there you go. I'll unmute myself, but stay very quiet.
All right, this picture was not sent in by a master gardener, but by Dr. Joe Neal in the Horticultural Science Department. Not that he didn't know what it was, but it was just pretty spectacular here on a tree in Wake County. And he said there was a tree that had something like 50 of these on it that he had noticed. He said it was as if it were decorated for Halloween. And I think we would all recognize this as the telial stage of cedar apple rust. And I'll mention in the bolos that we'll be looking out now in the month of May for the spermatial stage of this on the leaves of our apple trees. So one of our image submissions here was from a tomato in Craven County with the description that it was a plant in the backyard, raised bed, vegetable garden in Newbern. So all that's good kind of details to set the scene here. And also, since it's just one leaflet that's being photographed, it would have been helpful to have more to work with to be able to see, is there a variation in how this looks from leaf to leaf? Is it more on the upper leaves, more on the lower leaves, and so forth? What do the stems look like? All these would have been helpful to have also in the photographs, the underside of the leaf even perhaps. But it helps that the statement was there that most leaves on this plant are similar, and other tomato plants in the garden are beginning to show the same symptoms. My own research indicates that it may be tomato spotted leaf virus transferred by thrips. So far, I have not found any thrips on the plants, but I have not checked all plants yet. I would be pleased to know if this diagnosis is correct. Well, it may be. I can't really be sure. It certainly looks suspicious enough that if I saw more leaves and it continued to look suspicious, I would, and I had a plant in the lab, I would run the test for that particular virus. Now, don't use the absence of thrips as a reason to discount the possibility that it is tomato spotted wilt virus. And that's because the thrips don't have to actually colonize the plant. They move in from the weeds, which are the winter reservoirs of the virus. They move in to your garden and through their feeding activity transmit the virus, which shows up later. So you won't necessarily find the thrips. One thing that does seem to be a strike against the TSWV or tomato spotted wilt hypothesis here is that it just says other tomato plants in the garden are beginning to show the same symptoms. I misread that as most. So you wouldn't expect this to be on all the plants across the board. It would be scattered plants that happen to have been fed on by viruliferous, we call them thrips. So with this picture, able to say for sure, but yes, it could be TSWV. Unfortunately, if that is the case, there is no remedy for it, and the plant should probably be removed. Similarly, here was a potato leaf from Carteret County. It says evidence of brown spot fungus, which at first glance I thought might be early blight. In this case, it does not look to me like early blight. We actually don't have any records, at least going back to 2000 in the clinic database, of early blight on potato here. We do have some on tomato, and I'll show a photograph of that in the bolo so that you can get an idea of what to look for. But this, because of the distribution of the spots, the general yellowing of the leaf, it'd be good to know if this was a lower leaf or not, but I would suspect that this is more likely a nutrient deficiency type issue, especially if it's being seen on the lower leaves of the plant only, rather than some kind of a disease. Now you see flecking. I seem to remember that potato can get ozone injury as well, but we haven't had the hot days that we need to really get the ozone levels up to where I would expect damage on our potatoes. So my best guess here would be some kind of a nutrient issue. Oh, and somebody's saying, any asides regarding control would be useful. Okay, in this case, that I am not sure if it is a fertility issue, then maybe come in with a general fertilizer there, but have your soil tested in the fall for next year. Hopefully the testing will be opened up again before too long. We'll all be able to do that.
I know.
All right. Did I click too far? Let's see. No, this is one. So here's a case where a person sent in quite a few photographs, and many of them were helpful without reading the whole situation, but there's a lot of good background information here as to the age of the plant, which is something I forgot to mention is helpful to know. But we also see the setting tucked in the corner there, and the person particularly was interested in saying that they were not the one who planted it, that was prior to their moving into this particular house. And the question though, that it had flower blight, but, and you see in the photographs in the next picture that doesn't really seem to be the issue this year, as they say, but they see this year a black soot, and that it was apparently treated by a pest control operator or a landscaper with horticultural oil, but then they had to resort to a homemade soap solution during the quarantine days. So the main point here to notice is that we're talking about, it appears it's the lower leaves. And if you had this, the best way to check and make sure that this is in fact sooty mold, which again is caused by fungi, saprophytic fungi growing on the honeydew dripping down from the infested leaves above it, or even sometimes from plants or trees that are higher up above the plant that has the sooty mold. But just take a leaf and rub it firmly between your thumb and forefinger, and that coating of sooting mold will just come right off, and you'll see that there was no actual damage to the leaf tissue itself. It's blocking out light a little bit, but that shouldn't be an issue for a light infestation. The thing to do here is to determine what the insects are that are causing the honeydew and where they are, and deal with those. The other picture sent in with this one included a few photographs of the flower, which looks fine. And then there was mention also of some insects. Let's see, there was a few tiny bugs. Matt, I'm not sure if you can make those out or not. Your eye would be better than mine there. And then the rectangular white mass on the leaf in the last photo, which of course would be another scale and could be what was causing the honeydew that fed the sooty mold. So Matt, do you have a comment on that one?
Yeah, that little white patch on the underside of the leaf is definitely one of those exacts of the cottony scale. The cottony camellia scale is common on holly and other plants, especially camellia too, although it varies. And so that is good evidence that there was scale insects causing the sooty mold. I wasn't quite sure what other little insects there were. Very commonly on camellias, especially when there's sooty mold and pollen and everything on there, are bark lice. And they look like little flies or little aphids almost. They are harmless to the plant, but I would have to, you'd have to take a look at some photos to distinguish them.
All right. This iris sample or photograph, there are two more on the next slide, were sent in from a master gardener in Buncombe County who noticed it recently and wanted help with the photographs. Says these iris used to be in a shady area, but we lost the tree that shades them. I would imagine that the iris would have been actually happier in the higher light situation. And I don't think that this symptom has anything to do with that. It's a little hard to tell. You can tell a little bit better in the next photograph. But based on the very small lesions here, the chlorosis or yellowing they start out as, and they persist as a halo around it, and also the fact that the epidermis looks kind of broken here, I'm going to say that this is most likely iris rust, Auxinia iridis. It would be good to take a handkerchief or any kind of white tissue and rub it across this and see if you get the orangish or yellowish spores of the causal fungus. Because it's another iris disease, which I'll show in the bolos, does also cause leaf spots, and these though look a little bit more like they're going to be rust. This would have been a good thing to have under that little magnifying attachment or the plug-in scope that Charlotte was talking about. Then we could have probably been more definitive on this. Matt, I see that you have a question. You're just so popular, Matt, in the chat box here.
Okay, I'll have to take control to see the, whoops. Oh, oh no. Let me see chat. Where is? Okay. Let's see. So would that be the same as white flies? I'm not sure what that's in reference to. The bark lice are very different than white flies, completely different order. White flies, I don't know of white flies that attack camellia or some other plant. There's a lot of plants that white flies attack, typically gardenia, but you'd have to see very close-up photos of the actual pupae on the leaves, or shake the plant and see little tiny white flittering insects. But bark lice are very different. They are much bigger. They have clear wings with venation. They look like little aphids, like a mobile aphid. And it was on gardenia. Okay, so that's typically, gardenia seems to be the most common host for white flies. Now, I'm not sure if I have any other ones, but I'm going to give control back to Mike now.
All right, and I used that little interlude, thank you Matt, to go and get the link here. If you're interested, anyone's interested in more information about iris diseases, there's a fairly recent publication from, let's say, 2013, it's not the one I was thinking of, from the University of Arkansas on iris diseases. So continuing on.
I think you'll just have to click a couple times to take control. There you go.
All right. This one was sent in, I believe it's actually from Gina Meyer's own garden, our Wake County Extension agent, a Russian kale. And I have no idea what this is. The stem, lower stem tissue was getting swollen, kind of net-like, and eventually turning hollow. I bounced this off Sean Butler and Chris Gunter and Chris in the horticulture science department, and he thought maybe herbicide injury, but Katie Jennings in that same department didn't think it would be that, or hadn't seen anything like it, I guess is the way she said it. But you know, the swelling does suggest some kind of herbicide, but they were not applied. So this is really, this one's really a mystery to us as well. Some thickening of the stem, Chris was saying, can occur when you're, especially when you're harvesting leaves throughout the winter on these kales, but something like this, we are flummoxed. Gina also asked about her broccoli, and I'm a terrible person to ask about broccoli because I've had very little success with it. I would suspect that this is not a disease issue, but rather a kind of a temperature or other abiotic issue related to the way the broccoli is only producing these small heads like this. She thought maybe nutritional, and I suppose that's possible too. It doesn't look that robust in general. But again, I'm not the person to ask about broccoli. Both Gina and Matt had some photographs of the exobsidian leaf gall, those big fleshy galls on camellia. And you notice in Matt's on the left, can you see my cursor, by the way?
Yes.
All right, and on the left, Matt's picture shows that here's a leaf that only got partially infected. So it's swollen just on the distal portion, and the basal portion of the leaf looks normal. So this, if you first see them, pick them off before they have a chance to produce spores, and those spores end up overwintering in the buds, either as early infections, latent infections, or maybe even as spores, I'm not sure. And then in the springtime when the new growth emerges, that's when they start causing these galls. Again, a cosmetic issue and not one that we have to worry too much about. Gardenia from Wake County. And we did have another gardenia sample as well that came in as photographs. This is hard to say. Gardenia, you definitely want to look at the base of the lower stems to see if there was any evidence of cold injury. It does get root knot nematode. It does get phytophthora root rot. So this looks like some kind of a lower stem or probably root or soil issue that was causing the general yellowing and the blotching rather than a foliar disease per se. Here's another one where I'm really not sure what the answer is. More than anything else, I can say that it is not rust, which is the concern that the submitter had. So it's not a rust disease. It says every specimen has it. It's hard for me to say. I don't think it's a foliar issue. I think it's more likely a root or soil issue, but I can't say for sure what's going on. I believe I have a second photograph of this as well. No, this was the Verbena bonariensis. Here's some nice pictures, examples of, we don't see the whole landscape setting, but these are certainly good pictures and sufficient top and bottom to let you know that this is, as I'm sure many folks know, this is powdery mildew, which I've seen, as I recall, quite heavy on this particular species of Verbena in the past. And we have another case here with a lot of photographs that were submitted and helpful in this way. Here are some of the closer ones. So you can see the small leaves browning out, some defoliation. And the thing that was really helpful, well, first let me just mention they were concerned about black spot, which is the black spot that I know of is exclusive to roses. So it's not that, but the really helpful picture was, or pictures were from the landscape here. So you can see that there are sections of the plant dying out where other sections appear to be perfectly normal. Also, it looks like it's been going on for a while because there's some weeds growing there at the base of the plant, so some sunlight has been getting in. And this being azalea, there's a good chance that this is Phlomopsis canker, which has killed off sections. So you want to try and prune those out, but make sure and go several inches into clean wood. Of course, you're your aesthetics of the shrub are going to be affected by that. But if it gets down way to the soil line into the crown, then there's not much that you can do. Another thing to look for if you have branches of this is for that transition zone vertically or in cross-section to look for the kind of pie wedges of decaying or necrotic wood associated with the Phomopsis canker. So that would be my best guess on this particular azalea would be Phomopsis canker. And another one where I am fairly clueless as to why one of the peonies would have been growing well and the other not, assuming that they're both the same variety and so on, most likely some kind of a soil issue, but I would be hard pressed to say without actually seeing some of the roots and the crown there to look at and see if there were issues.
Mike, I'll say I'm a little suspicious. You see how the mulch is kind of caved in beside the smaller one?
Yes.
I'm wondering if that could be voles. I've had some plants this year attacked by voles over the winter, and you know, the telltale sign is tunneling, or of course, if you dig them up, you see that the roots are all gnawed off or the crown's gnawed on.
Oh, okay. That's a good point, Charlotte.
The only thing I'd be suspicious with that is that the foliage looks good. So I would expect some kind of wilting if the roots were gnawed or browning, but they just look small and not as thrifty as or thriving as the other ones. So, but yeah, it's a good thing to do is to dig away a little bit. Note, and voles will eat a lot of different plants.
So I believe that with that, I will let Matt grab control of his computer again and
okay.
Talk about some more insect stuff.
You gave me control again? Great. Okay.
I did, but I have to see what the last comment in the chat was. Would it be helpful to slide a piece of light paper behind stem or leaf photos to add contrast? Well, that's something you'll have to see on a case-by-case basis, I think. Sometimes well, Matt does that a lot with the insects, but sometimes I find that if the paper is too light, then it makes it hard. The camera will adjust the exposure and you will underexpose the specimen. So a piece of kind of gray or, you know, bluish paper is sometimes better than pure black or pure white.
Okay, I wanted to just very quickly go back to this one photo of the azalea. And you can actually see some of the azalea bark scales, a felt scale here. So this is not only some maybe disease and other issues, there are scales on there. Sometimes it's actually a chicken and egg case though, where the plants that are not as healthy will be more attractive to pests.
And okay. In fact, that's the case in general with canker diseases, that they tend to be problems on stress plants, although those look well cared for, I would say. All right, Matt, are you accidentally muted?
You don't appear to be muted, but we're not hearing you, Matt.
Oh, maybe he lost his connection.
He still seems to be in the session. Usually somebody loses the connection, they drop out of the participant box.
All right, yeah, I did lose connection. Everybody there?
Oh, good, yeah.
Okay, you hear me now? Okay, great, sorry about that. Okay, I don't know what you heard last, but basically the way the eggs are laid, the shape, all that stuff helps identify what types of eggs. This is a little bit difficult. But they look almost like some kind of leaf-footed bug eggs. If they were moth eggs or lepidopteran eggs, they're typically round or spherical, not oblong. They're a little shiny, which is similar to some leaf-footed bugs. But I actually probably should do a whole session on eggs of different insects and arthropods because they can be very distinct or they can be very difficult to identify. Okay, here's some really good photos actually on azalea. It looks sick. Leaves are discolored and there seems to be small insects on the bottom of the leaves. This is very, very characteristic of azalea lace bug. So this is not a disease over here on the left, although it's a very nice photo showing bleached out chlorotic or stippled pattern on the tops of leaves that's resulting from feeding on the undersides. And luckily these images were big enough that I was able to zoom in and you can very clearly see the fecal spots everywhere and the actual culprits right here, the azalea lace bug. They do start to hatch from eggs that overwintered on the underside of the leaves at this time of year. So check your azaleas if you've had issues before in the past. Those eggs may still be there and you'll want to take a look at them and especially looking at the undersides. Okay, so this is an interesting one. The person sent it in, didn't know exactly what type of plant this was. Doesn't remember these growths last year, but sees all these crazy growths all over the plant in a natural area. This one was interesting because I could kind of tell what the plant was pretty well, but the actual objects helped confirm the ID of the host, which can actually sometimes happen. One thing I will also note is that it's great to have a ruler here to show the size of those bumps. These bumps are actually phylloxerin galls on hickory. So hickory has these compound leaves, usually very large. They're very common all out in the environment. And these galls are created by an aphid-like insect that overwinters as eggs on the bark. And what happens is then a foundress female will crawl into the buds when they're just starting to grow, start to encase itself in the tissue, the plant tissue, and by the time the leaves are big, you get this big ball, and inside there, the foundress is laying eggs. The eggs are gonna hatch, they're gonna live their cycle, and winged members of the gall are gonna come out, mate, and lay more eggs on other hickories. It is very sporadic too. So some of the person also sent a number of photos of other plants of the same species nearby that didn't have any. It really is every year and different areas can be hit at different ways. Now these won't hurt the plants. The plants have evolved with them for many, many thousands, millions of years. And so these just are, they look weird, but they're not going to actually kill the plant, as with many leaf galls. And I'm going to mention that that also brings up some other galls that are coming out. So somebody else sent a witch hazel leaf. These little, these big galls on the upper surface of the leaves of witch hazel are very characteristic of witch hazel aphid, gall aphid. If you cut that open, you'd see a colony of fuzzy aphids. And then Mike actually sent me this very interesting oak species. I think it was swamp oak. Is that what you were thinking it was, Mike?
I was thinking it was water oak.
Or water oak, sorry. Both watery, I guess. But this is a very interesting one. This is not the wool sower, which is the big puffy one that you see on other oaks oftentimes with pink spots. But I got an ID from a friend, and these are actually in the flowers. They're a gall of the flowers of this type of oak. I don't remember what the species was, but it's not a very well-studied one. So it's a very interesting one, Mike. Thanks. But oak galls are going to be developing now, and those are wasps in the family Cynipidae that create those. Okay, here's another photo. There was an explanation about killing bugs and, you know, learning more and leaving them alone. I really do encourage people to keep an innocent till proven guilty kind of attitude toward insects. Most of the insects and critters around your home and gardens are either neutral or beneficial. They're not going to hurt you or your plants. And this is why we do this, is to help people understand which ones can be pests, which ones are beneficials, which ones can actually be damaging and should be controlled. So definitely send us photos, send us specimens, learn more about each of these individual things. And in this case, there's this, it's giving me a message that my internet is unstable. So if I drop out, can everybody still hear me?
I can still hear you.
Hello?
Yep, we can hear you.
I can hear you just fine. I can
hear. We may have lost him again.
While he's reconnecting, hopefully, I did see a couple of questions in the chat about azalea lace bug treatment. And azalea lace bug can be controlled, you can spray them with insecticidal soap when the lace bug are present, but to really control them, it takes multiple treatments because you have several generations through the year. Some of the neonicotinoid insecticides can actually be really effective for controlling azalea lace bug for a whole season.
Hey, Charlotte, can you hear me now?
Yes, good. Welcome back.
Okay, good. Okay, sorry, my internet's is going in and out apparently. Okay, so quickly through this, this bug is not a wheel bug. It's actually one that overwinters as an adult. This is actually one of the large leaf-footed bugs in the genus Acanthocephala. And in fact, a couple weeks ago, I saw two species right at the same time. Terminalis has this orange tips of the antennae. Declivis has this very broad thorax with a gray dusting right here. They're very large, but they're harmless. They feed on random plants in the environment. They are not considered pests. Be impressed by their size, but don't worry about them. Don't smash them. They are just out there doing their thing. Okay, then I got an email, an image of this. So a few branches of my arborvitae have portions that are dead. Studied them and saw these what were cocoons. And they were not noticed till last year until the fall and the limbs started dying. So the problem with this photo, it's a good photo of the actual thing, but what I requested then was a photo of the entire plant because we'd like to see what the foliage looks like in general, what the distribution of branches are that are being affected. And luckily they sent me this showing that the most of the tree was green and happy, but these areas where these in quotes cocoons are actually very defoliated. And this is actually fairly typical of a high infestation of bagworms. These are the evergreen bagworm, and right now, actually, you should be looking for plants that have been infested by these and cutting with a razor bags off of the plant. You want to slice the attachment point and unwrap it so it doesn't girdle those stems. Now, this plant will take a while to come back, if at all, on those branches. It may be a little lopsided still, but removing as many of those bags right now will help if any of the eggs are beginning to hatch, to get rid of them, because the eggs are actually inside these bags and have been overwintering. Another photo, although a little unclear, that was sent with this set shows this is the pupal case of a male that came from the bag. And what he does is he actually mates with the bags that contain a female last year, and then she'll lay eggs. The eggs will overwinter and hatch very soon.
Matt, let me interrupt there because I think it's both of us who need to address the question in the chat box about the best way to identify a fungal versus an insect gall.
Yeah, so I would say, you know, cutting them open is one thing. If you cut it open, find a little critter, that's gonna be an insect or arthropod gall. Some galls contain small mites, aerified mites, that are much too small to see. But basically, fungal galls are fairly uncommon and very, Mike, you can correct me, but are fairly host-specific and very specific looking. So first of all, knowing the type of plant is gonna help a lot in knowing which galls are which. But Mike, you wanna add any suggestions?
I couldn't have said it better myself. They're very specific. So for example, black knot on cherry. So you know it's a black cherry and it's got this big rough knot-looking thing on it. Now, there are also some bacterial galls, such as lower petalum knot, crown gall, for example. But knowing the specific host that you're looking at will help you identify that. Also, off the top of my head, I can't think of any other than the exobasidium leaf galls, which look quite different. I can't think of any fungal galls on leaves. So those would be quite unusual. If you're seeing it on leaves, then there's a pretty good chance that it's an insect. Mm-hmm.
And we showed some leaf galls on azalea last year, and critter or not, I think they were fungal and very distinct. I didn't know exactly because some gall midges might create similar ones, but when we got them in, it was easy to dissect and show that it was not filled with insects. So yeah, break them open. So break them open, cut them open, you know, use a razor or knife and split it open. You can, you should be able to see something. But when in doubt, send us photos. All right, so we're going pretty long. I'm hoping people are still interested and want to stay on. I'm happy to keep going with everything, and I'm not sure, but I'll just keep going. So here was an interesting one. This was found a large pile of these tiny critters in the soil when I pulled back last fall's pine straw. That was the spring. Used a leaf as reference, but gave a length of the leaf. Now, unfortunately, the image, it's a little unclear. The critter probably should be bigger than the image and a little bit clearer, maybe a couple different views. But what it looks like to me, being this brown, leathery, and probably no legs and no head, it looks like probably crane fly larvae. I talked about them last time we spoke, talking about flooding and these larvae coming out of the soil and congregating. They're going to be feeding on detritus and decaying vegetable matter. So they are not a pest, but they can be present in large numbers sometimes. Okay, I think this is actually my last one. So this was from somebody who sent Marshall Warren. So I'm assuming it's the Johnson County one. This picture had this photo of an insect on a corkscrew willow. Bark and leaf sent to me from a client wants to know what it is. Is it a pest or beneficial? So again, here's a good good question. Is it a pest or beneficial? So as far as I know, so based on where it was, it's on a willow. This time of year, there are two major beetle species that are on willows. The imported willow leaf beetle, which is a very small blue one, and the Chrysomela willow leaf beetles, which are native larger ones. This is one of them. From its size, I bet it's the Chrysomela one because they're a bit bigger. And considering the leaf width on here, I figured that it was a bit bigger. This is where the larva actually slows down and starts to contract. And as soon enough, it'll attach like here, even on nearby objects. It'll shed this last larval skin and then become a pupa. And so that's good clues. These white dots on here were fairly good clues. Now there are some lady beetles or some ladybugs that pupate in a very similar way. So knowing the host, knowing where there's damage and maybe catching some larvae or pupae could help also. So just taking good clear photos would help there too. And again, with decent photos, you can get a pretty good idea of many of the insects out there. Okay, and last one on this hollyhock. So there's a number of feeding holes everywhere. There was a picture of this critter. I'm sure many of you will recognize this as a daddy long legs or an apilionid. These are not plant feeders, so it's just incidental. They're scavengers or weak predators. As far as what's chewing them, it's very difficult to know for a couple reasons. One is that we don't see any undersides of the leaves. So oftentimes insects like caterpillars and sawflies, things like that, feed on the undersides of the leaves. And so flipping it over and taking photos of anything that's under there is very helpful. The other thing is that some critters only come out at night to feed, or they'll kind of move to the bottom of the plant, the base of the plant, and wait until night where there's not as many predators like birds and such. And so scouting at different times of day can really help too. So if you're finding things at night, use a flash, take photos, and still kind of use the similar guidelines for taking good clear photos. Okay, I'm gonna check the chat. I saw a couple people were, let's see. Okay, some people leaving. Sorry you have to go. Sorry it's taken so long, but we're trying to get through all these fun photos. I see, can large numbers of crane fly larvae be related to summer before and moist soil conditions enabling more of the eggs and larvae to survive? It may be. Crane fly larvae can live sometimes more than a year, so it's not always the previous year's or this year's conditions. And many crane flies, like I said before, will emerge at different times of the year. So they may be smaller, some species may be smaller at this time of year, others may be finishing up their development. So it's very difficult to say. With April being so persistently cool and moist, and with cool weather, has this resulted in emergence or hanging out particular disease or pests? It's tough right now. And when I talk about the bolos in a second, I'll tell you, I think all bets are off recently. So with that, we'll just wrap it up with some bolos. So arthropod bolos, so cicadas, I've dug up one and I got some photos sent to me of the nymphs being dug up. Everybody's doing yard work now because they're stuck at home. When you're digging in the soil, you may find these cicada nymphs just either waiting for later in the summer, or Jim Baker actually sent me a photo of a periodical cicada, these black and orange with red eye cicadas. We are set to have brood 9 come out this year in central, west central North Carolina. So they may be making a lot of rackets soon. Now, whether his was one of this brood's, or sometimes they're stragglers that don't get the message and emerge either a year earlier or a year later, we don't know. But most cicadas, the annual cicadas are going to be emerging later in the summer. But again, with the periodical cicadas and other weird conditions, who knows? I've seen a lot of May beetles out. So these large nut-like chestnut brown or reddish brown beetles, they're going to be coming to lights. They're harmless. Their larvae, very, very infrequently may do damage to grass, but they're almost certainly just out there in the environment feeding on detritus and in the soil. Bagworms, like I mentioned, this is a good time of year to remove the bags from the plants that are infested with them. If they've already hatched, what you can do is you can actually bang the branches onto a sheet of paper, look for these little tiny larvae. They may not have yet made the case, but even when they are small, they will make a little case, and you can see this is the needle from an arborvitae or Leyland. I think it's an arborvitae. And so you can see how tiny these bags can be early on. So you want to search those trees now, and this is the best time to treat if they begin to emerge. Lots of garden bugs and caterpillars are coming out. These are the rosemary leafhoppers all over my thyme. They're all over the rosemary, the oregano, lots of the mint family that we like to eat as herbs. And they create these patches of white feeding damage where they suck out the green and the liquids. And lots and lots and lots of other critters. Honestly, all bets are off. Like I said, this year the weather is very strange. It's been fairly mild, but we also didn't get a lot of freezes early on. Some things are coming out much earlier. Some things are coming out a little later. And basically in May, you're going to start seeing a lot of crazy things. You may see things like these rosy maple moths. You may see some stilt-legged flies. But basically just all the critters are starting to wake up and be active. And so nothing specific that I can tell you, but keep sending photos and keep letting us know. And with that, I'll turn it over to Mike for his bolos.
So on the disease side of the equation, going back to the question from T. Packer, a lot is going to depend on how much rainfall we get as far as what's going to happen with the diseases, both the foliar diseases that are driven by leaf wetness and the root diseases, which excess soil moisture, some of those are favored by that. You may not see the effects until later stressful hot weather comes along, but we shall see. So starting out with our bolos for May, in general, in mulch beds, you may start to see the yellowish at first fruiting. The exact name, it's not a sporangium, there's a technical term for it, and I can't remember now, but of the fruiting bodies of these phlegoseptica, the dog vomit slime molds. Athelia, that's the word. Also, over and under fertilization in the garden and herbicide injury. So as you're going out there trying to get your poison ivy controlled, you want to make sure that no glyphosate drift gets near the tomatoes, or you'll get something that looks like the picture on the far right there. muscadine grape is very sensitive to some of the synthetic auxin herbicides. So something like a 2,4-D will cause damage, as you see in the picture in the upper middle of the slide here. In the vegetable garden, you could be seeing some Pythium root rot or damping off going on. When you're buying your your tomato and pepper transplants, be especially on the lookout for a couple of different things. One of them being bacterial leaf spot. The diagnosis is complete, but there is an example there in the lower left of what is probably bacterial leaf spot on some pepper seedlings from a greenhouse grower. So make sure you're planting clean transplants. The picture in the lower middle, that is early blight on tomato. Notice how the lesion is a little bit larger than those small flecks that we saw on the potato image that was submitted. Also notice the concentric rings there. That's not exclusive to early blight, but that is fairly typical of early blight, which will also affect the stems. And tomato spotted wilt virus, which would be coming in from the weeds, again, as you mentioned earlier, and moving into the tomatoes, you can see there's a photograph there on the lower right of tomato spotted wilt virus symptoms on tomato. In the fruit trees and shrubs, cane blights and rust diseases on blackberry, fire blight you could be seeing on apple, and also picture in the upper right there, that's that spermatial stage of cedar apple rust on the apple leaves, and then the EC develop a little bit later in the summer on those, produce the spores that go and infect the junipers. Blueberry, you could see some Botrytis canker or dieback, but also this one that we've had fairly recent years only, as far as I know, the Exobasidium leaf and fruit spot. It's almost a white spot on those blueberry leaves. So that's in the same genus as what causes those camellia galls and rhododendron galls. Downy mildew on bunch grape, as well as anthracnose to be looking out for there. On our shade trees and shrubs, I've already seen what I think is probably philostick the leaf spot on maple. Anthracnose will be coming on if it's not there already. Powdery mildew on euonymus, especially starting on dogwood, on spirea, maybe some other things too. Exobasidium, we've already mentioned. Phytophthora and armillaria root rots, those you can have trees going declining any time of year, but the actual infection would have taken place quite a bit sooner. And I think there was a misunderstanding in last months about the root rots here. With armillaria, that's the one where if you confirm it, then yeah, you don't want to plant any kind of woody host in that spot for a couple of years. With Phytophthora, it's a question of deciding what you're going to put there that will have fewer problems. Some tip dieback on your Leyland cypress, especially if it's kind of an orange color, could very well be ceridium canker. And don't forget to be on the lookout for rose rosette on the young growth of your rose bushes. In the perennial and annual flower beds, that nice ring spot look to the peonies is caused by tobacco rattle virus, unfortunately incurable. Daylily leaf streak, picture in the very bottom there, typically has the necrotic portion traveling down in a V shape down the midrib of the daylily. Powdery mildew on coreopsis. Iris leaf spot, picture there on the far right, so possibly a little bit larger, well, could be quite a bit larger than your rust pustules, but this being another fungus causing that. And iris does have additional problems such as bacterial soft rot of the rhizomes, often associated with an insect that's boring down in there. And finally, a septoria leaf spot of rudbeckia. On the turf side of things, information I get or had received from Lee Butler, some of the things to be watching for would be brown patch as the hot weather finally arrives. When it does, we'll be seeing our fescue, for example, lower right picture there with brown patch. Fairy ring on any kind of turf grass in the upper right. Large patch, which is a similar fungus to what causes brown patch, but it's going to be on the warm season grasses and when those are under stress from cool weather. And of course, still some spring dead spot as the Bermuda and Zoysia recover from dormancy, except where the fungus had damaged them last fall. Finally, you notice that Matt had some connection problems, and there's a lot of demand for the internet these days. And our very own Extension Master Gardener Coordinator is developing a whole new internet to be launched very soon. And sources close to PP&P have said on condition of anonymity that since the names Internet 2, Internet of Things have already been taken, that this is going to be known as Charlotte's Web. Now, also, these sources tell us that the prototype was a little bit slow. You had to give the message, and then it was posted to the web overnight to be read there. But they are hopeful that things will be coming along nicely, so it's something to be on the lookout for. And since we have plenty of oregano but are running out of time, I guess we'll take any last questions as we give the announcement for next month, where Sam Marshall will be joining us to talk about where the wild things are, larval host plants for butterflies and moths, on our fourth Tuesday of May. And if you or other folks you know have missed the things that we've been talking about, there are places you can go to get the recordings, see what we've been up to on our playlist and the schedule archives. So with that, any last questions or comments?
So Mike, the Charlotte's Web is particularly true because, you know, I did grow up on a pig farm.
All right.
I'm here still. Let me take a look at some of the, if there are any questions.
There were some questions about periodic cicada maps, and I found the Forest Service had one that I posted a link to. Do you guys know of a better one or anything that's really specific just to North Carolina?
There's a few. Here you go. Here's one called Cicada Mania, which actually has a lot of good information about the different broods. There was one called magicicada.org. It almost looks like magic cicada, but that's the genus name is magicicada. Let me see if it was not up when I, let's see. It's not up the last time I, it was not coming up when I tried to click it yesterday. So I was taking a look at that. That was a pretty good one too. But Cicada Mania has some good information on it about the different broods, where they are historically. And it's really interesting. Okay, let's see if there, I'm gonna go up and see if there are any other questions that need identifying.
I did have a question from, or I noticed a question from my weed of the month I didn't get to was there a way to tell the difference between poison ivy seedlings and Virginia creeper seedlings, which can look extremely similar when they first emerge? And I do not have a tip for that. I would just treat any seedling with three leaflets suspiciously. Once they get older, the Virginia creeper will have the five leaflets.
Yeah, I'd be curious about that. I know that you know, there are a lot of three-leaved plants out there, and it seems like for poison ivy, the petioles of the leaves are really important. So the center leaf, usually leaflet, usually has a longer petiole compared to the other two, the lateral ones. So
right.
I don't know. Yeah. I don't know what Virginia creeper looks like when it first emerges, but yeah.
I thought there was a couple of questions about managing tent caterpillars.
Yes, that there's, I'm sure, let me see if there's a NC State publication on that. I'm sure there is. One of the things is if you do find them tents, which again, at this time, seeing some cocoons and stuff, it's probably well over now. But if you do see the tents, to rip them open, not to burn them. To try and allow predators to go in. Let's see. Yeah, there's not a lot of information. Let's see if I can find some. Steve Frank has a couple things. Minda wrote something up. One thing is also to use recommended products on the leaves near the nest, and that'll be where they're feeding. Okay, well, I think if we don't have any other questions, well, thanks for everyone for sticking by as long as you could. We had a lot of fun images from everyone to take a look at, and hope we answered people's submissions as well as we could. And hopefully you're out there taking more photos, and let us know what you see.
All right, and blessings of health to everyone, and we'll hopefully see you in a month.
All right, thank you all. I'm going to stop the recording.